Good morning and welcome to Morning Movie News. Now on Sunday, Michael Douglas won a Golden Globe for his portrayal of Liberace, who was partial to sequin capes. And then the very next day, Marvel announced that he'd be moving to a different world of capes to play Hank Pym in their Ant-Man movie for Edgar Wright. And even more so, he would be the villain of the film. Now, this was a fascinating development, not just because of what it says about Marvel's casting practices, but also potentially about the film, which has been a big question mark, perhaps the biggest question mark, even more so out of Guardians of the Galaxy as that film approaches its release date, for people really not understanding how Edgar Wright could successfully adapt what seems to be a very difficult and delicate character. You know, is it going to be too family, too comedy? Will it be able to compete with the more well-known superheroes, etc.? So let's start out with what this says about Marvel as a company, as a studio, and their casting practices. Now, a lot of people said when this news was announced about Michael Douglas that it was wonderful that Marvel Studios were willing to consider older actors. For instance, when we discussed here the Denzel Washington news for Green Lantern, a lot of people said, he's too old. And, you know, when Angelina Jolie's name was coming up for Wonder Woman, again, people said, too old. And then here you have Michael Douglas. Now, someone could counter, well, he is coming in here to play the villain. So who knows how long he'll last, or it's not quite as big a role. Maybe it won't incorporate as much action. On a side note, I hope it does. I hope we get to see Michael Douglas really get to play, you know, Hank Pym is a superhero or was a superhero. He has those powers. I want to see Michael Douglas in the thick of it. I think that would be part of what makes the movie exciting. So here you have Marvel, though. While everyone's saying everyone's too old for DC, Marvel is casting Michael Douglas, you know, who's recovered from throat cancer, to play a really exciting, compelling role. But, however, when you think about it, while this might be new, something that DC isn't exploring, this is becoming actually perhaps a formula for Marvel, because Robert Redford is in Captain America 2, also potentially playing the villain. He let that slip, I believe. It might be a misdirect. Maybe Robert Redford is more clever than we all imagined. But, so he's in Captain America 2 and the Winter Soldier, and also Glenn Close is in Guardians of the Galaxy. So I would caution Marvel to not make this seem like a formula, because that will take away from the, the uniqueness and the special quality, you know, that they're willing to consider different age groups, and hopefully down the line, different, races and stuff. Because as everyone said, I thought I did a series of videos on Guardians of the Galaxy, and someone wrote about Rocket Raccoon. I can't believe Rocket Raccoon is more doable than Black Panther for a movie. So I think there's a palpable frustration that there isn't enough diversity in these movies. So hopefully that'll be the next step. But we are having diversity in terms of age. So I really do hope that, you know, this isn't like a token character, because it seems to me that Robert Redford and Glenn Close are on the sidelines of their movies, really just kind of add some cachet. As I said, I really want Michael Douglas to be an involved villain, very much the villain of the piece. And I think he'd be great at it. Now, what does this say about the potential film? I think a lot of us wondered how Hank Pym, who is a very flawed character in the comics, could be portrayed as a hero on the silver screen, especially for Marvel's films, which, you know, are supposed to have a family audience. We've always been talking about the fact, you know, Hank Pym has famously hit his wife, Janet Van Dyne, a.k.a. the Wasp. Oh, and that's another question. Will the Wasp be Michael Douglas's age? I hope so. I mean, I hope that they don't mess up continuity. One of the big problems we all have with the X-Men movies is that they switch generations all the time. For instance, Havoc right now is alive in the First Class universe. Well, Cyclops, apparently, I don't know what happened to, you know, I'm assuming he's still in the current timeline. So you have a situation where they go from being brothers to maybe, you know, uncle, you know, nephew. I mean, it's the generational stuff gets all messed up. And these generational, relationships matter. I mean, they play into the mythos of these characters and the legends. So Janet Van Dyne belongs with Hank Pym. So I think that by casting Michael Douglas, you could be opening the door for some very interesting casting for the Wasp. At least I hope so. And of course, Paul Rudd was therefore confirmed he'll be playing Scott Lang, which makes sense because there was a casting notice for someone to play the daughter of the main character, who I'm assuming now we all know will be Cassie Lang, who eventually also takes on the Pym particles to become, I think she largely got really big in the comics. She was in the Young Avengers series. And she died. I don't know if they'll do that in the movies, but that was a big thing for Scott Lang, one of his, I think, bigger character arcs, actually. But so we all wondered how someone like Hank Pym could be interpreted to mainstream audiences as a hero. You know, he originally created Ultron. Maybe with someone like Michael Douglas, he might be involved again. Maybe that's how they might have gotten him in. They were like, you're going to have a cameo in the Avengers for having created this. It's going to be really big. And Michael Douglas was like, okay, you twisted my arm. So that's, I think when you have someone like Michael Douglas for a role like Hank Pym, it's not going to be thrown away. It would be stupid to throw it away. It needs to be really ingrained. So I think it's really brilliant. And also with the spousal abuse, I think that Michael Douglas is the kind of actor who I think could pull that off, you know, make it seem like as horrible as it is, but yet still, you know, not make the character totally, you know, written off. I mean, that's a delicate line to walk, but Michael Douglas has walked it so many times. We're talking about the Fatal Attraction, Basic Instinct actor. I mean, this is just right up his alley. So I think that's a really interesting thing that they're going to be doing with the film. I have to say, I think that when they cast Paul Rudd, it had a little bit of a family feel to the movie. I mean, I'm still excited about the Paul Rudd casting. I'm even more excited about this movie now. And also, think about it. Michael Douglas will be saying lines from Edgar Wright and in an Edgar Wright movie. That's just brilliant. And I think that Michael Douglas brings a layer of or an aspect of sophistication to this film, which I think it's really going to need. And also, again, another thing that I think, that, as I mentioned with Denzel Washington, that I think that the comic book movies should be aware of, and I'm sure Marvel is, that's why they're casting these actors, is when you cast these older, more established actors, they have their fan bases, their older fan bases, and it brings them into the movie. Whereas someone might have been like, Hank Pym is a dad who can shrink or grow really big. This is a movie for kids or for people with kids. And then all of a sudden they're like, but Michael Douglas is the villain. And all of a sudden that moviegoer goes, well, you know what? Maybe I should check it out. So I think it's brilliant casting. I think it has the potential to be a really good villain. That's another thing we've been talking about, a lack of really good villains in the Marvel Cinematic Universe. So watch your back, Loki. You might have some company with Michael Douglas and James Spader coming down the line. That's very exciting news. All right, so that's the first story of the day. The second story of the day also pertains to comics, and that there was a big news. You know, they're having these big television conferences right now, and we're getting a lot of television news. And of course, Fox is talking about their potential Gotham show, which is trying to come out in the 2014-2015 television season. It's moving forward. You know, we'll see if it gets the actual green light, but considering all the buzz that it has, it probably will. But what really surprised people was the announcement that this is supposed to be Jim Gordon's early years. But it was announced yesterday that those early years would include a number of very familiar faces to people who read Batman comics or see Batman movies. And that Bruce Wayne will appear in the series as a 12-year-old boy, and the investigation into his parents' murder will be still ongoing, and Jim Gordon will be tied into that. That's something that the movies have tried to do, saying that Jim Gordon, you know, Nolan did that when Jim Gordon put his coat around young Bruce Wayne. And also in the comics, Scott Snyder is exploring the fact that Bruce Wayne blames Jim Gordon for his parents' death because he equates him with the corrupt police department, and that's like a bone of contention between them because they're right now doing the early years of Bruce Wayne in the comics. So not only will there be a young Bruce Wayne around, 12 years old, a young Ben Affleck, but other Batman villains will be showing up pre-Batman for Gordon to take on. The names they mentioned were Catwoman and the Penguin. Now, how Catwoman, the romantic interest for Batman for decades, could show up when he's only 12, unless, you know, it's like a really interesting relationship, but they're going to go with that dynamic. Maybe she's like in her late teens, and so she's only about a couple years older than Bruce Wayne? I don't know. I mean, I guess they could go in that direction. But I think always a big point of Batman is that he has come first, and his taking on the Batman persona to instill fear in regular criminals is what inspired criminals themselves to step up their game to take on kind of their own mythos. So to take away that first step, you know, it's like, it's not the chicken or the egg. It's very clear, Batman, then the villains. But if you switch it around, then you're almost saying that Batman was inspired not famously by that bat in year one that crashes through his father's study, but by other criminal elements. And he's really not the trailblazer here, but, you know, just following an already existing trend or phenomenon, I guess. I think trend is a very casual term for these criminals who kill tons of people and really wreak havoc in Gotham. So that's a really interesting, and I feel devastating blow to the character personally. I'm a big Batman fan. I really believe in these characters. I think that I have a video coming out later this week that discusses this, but, you know, I think that you don't mess with some of the facts about Batman, and this is clearly messing with one. We just talked about generational things with Michael Douglas, with Hank Pym versus Janet Van Dyne, where she'll be. I have a big problem with messing up the generational aspects here in Batman's world. Now, there might be some case, now, but this makes me feel, if they're going to be so heavily setting up Gotham on the small screen, I feel largely this indicates that the Justice League is going to take over the big screen movies. They're only going to make Justice League movies. Just like Robert Downey Jr. only wants to make Avengers movies. I think Warner Brothers is like, we're not going to mess around. The day of the single superhero movie is done. Tell that to Thor and Iron Man, Thor 2 and Iron Man 3 and the upcoming Captain America, The Winter Soldier. That's my favorite, that's the most anticipated comic book movie for 2014, for me, by the way. Captain America, The Winter Soldier. I have very high hopes for it because I think it's going to do something very different. I think it's going to be like a spy thriller in the superhero genre, and I'm very excited to see Marvel pull that off. I think that'll really impress a lot of people and show that comic book movies don't always have to be the same type of thing, which comic book readers know, but moviegoers don't. But anyway, back to this. So I think Warner Brothers just wants to do Justice League movies, which I think that makes sense. And then they're like these characters, smaller universes, that basically the cities they come from, so maybe there'll be a Central City television series, all those things, a Metropolis you could potentially have, I guess, I don't know, but they're like, and also because they're having an older Batman in the movies with Ben Affleck, there might be no room for Gordon. And if Ben Affleck's Batman is dealing with intergalactic threats, as the Justice League tends to do, Justice League doesn't have adventures in Gotham, you're going to have a situation where they're like, well, we don't want to lose Jim Gordon, so let's set him up on the small screen. So that could be what you have Warner Brothers building here. The big Justice League movies and then the small television shows which take on they're saying, lower tier characters. But to relegate the Batman movies to the small screen after they have been the bread and butter for the DC Warner Brothers relationship seems like a really big gamble. I think that they would want to take another character, maybe the Central City aspect, and do that. I mean, CW has taken those characters though, but look at Netflix. What are they putting on the small screen? Legitimately smaller tier characters. You don't take your, purists could say Superman is the crown jewel of the DC empire, but I think it's Batman. And take that and stick it on television. I mean, unless maybe cable television, I'd have much more faith in this if this was going to be an HBO or AMC or even FX television show. In fact, this is on Fox. I mean, I hope it's good, but network television, even Almost Human is falling into a procedural. I think network television shows just don't have the willpower to become these sprawling epics. They want their cut and dried episodes. So I'm very nervous about this. And I'm very nervous, I mean, as I've said before, how many times can DC reboot? I mean, before it just becomes garbage. All right, so that's the second story of the day. Now, the third story of the day is a very sad story, and that deals with the shooting in a movie theater in Florida yesterday, which you might have heard about, where someone was actually shot and killed over texting in a movie theater. Now, the story, the details are that a 43-year-old man and his wife went to see a showing of Lone Survivor in the afternoon, and also a 71-year-old retired former police officer and his wife went to see the same showing. Now, during the previews, the 43-year-old was texting. And making some kind of noise, apparently, is what witnesses were saying. And the 71-year-old asked him to stop, and the man didn't. So the 71-year-old got up and left the theater. And presumably people say to go and get a manager or somebody. But he came back alone. And when he came back, the 43-year-old stood up and confronted him and asked him and demanded to know if he had reported him for texting. And he said, I was just texting my 3-year-old daughter. And apparently the argument escalated from there. Popcorn was thrown. Nobody said who threw the popcorn. It wasn't specified. But the next action was that the 71-year-old was carrying a firearm, drew his weapon, and shot the 43-year-old in the chest. He also managed to hit the 43-year-old's wife, who put her hand up to defend her husband. And then the 43-year-old collapsed on some fellow moviegoers, a man and his own son, who were there to see the film, I believe for the father's birthday. And the 43-year-old passed away on the scene. There were some nurses there, but they couldn't save him. And there was also an off-duty officer, a law enforcement official, and he detained the 71-year-old, and he is under arrest. But the 43-year-old has lost his life. Now, this is really obviously a tragic situation, and I think anyone who goes to the theaters these days is really can understand how appalling and the anger that it causes in even the most calmest individual, the disregard for fellow moviegoers. It's really appalling. Now, of course, obviously, nobody deserves to die over something like that. It's just tragic and a senseless, literally a senseless death. But I think that there are some things that should be taken away from this. I think, first of all, never, you know, escalate an argument. I think that the 43-year-old, he should not have confronted him. I think the 71-year-old shouldn't have come back by himself. I don't know why this was left to be dealt with on their own. I think that you don't know what the other person in an argument is capable of. You don't know what they could have on their person. And I think that even if you think you're in the right, even if you are sure that you are doing the right thing, you are not. This is not the Wild West. There are authority figures around and easy to come across. So if you feel that if anything is making you uncomfortable, if you feel you're in a fight and things seem to be escalating on the other behalf of the other person and you're caught up in it, don't feel that you can, I can handle this. Leave the theater if you're uncomfortable. Go and get that authority figure at any age. I'm sure, you know, some people might, I'm an adult, I can take care of this. You know, this isn't just a message for children. You know, you don't know what other people are capable of, especially in a society like today, where anyone can be walking around with a firearm. And you might think, well, you know, in civilized countries, this doesn't happen. It does happen. So I would implore you not to take matters into your own hands with things like this. We are fortunate enough to have, you know, systems set up to take care of these things and to handle it, and that should be done. I mean, that brings me to the movie theater, though. At the end, CNN reported this story, and at the end of the article, they mentioned that on the website for this movie theater in Florida, it was a chain, and they said there's no texting allowed during the movie, and no firearms are allowed in the theater. And yet, neither of these rules, you know, these so-called guidelines, were enforced. And I think that the movie theaters really need to start taking responsibility for ensuring the safety, not only a nice movie-going experience, but the safety of their customers. I mean, what happened in Colorado, that's because no one was watching the emergency exit doors on the theater. The shooter was allowed to come into the theater, leave out the emergency exit, keep it propped open, and come back in. No security whatsoever. It is a dangerous situation, as we're seeing, to put a bunch of strangers in a dark room together and just leave them to their own devices. Movie theaters have to start realizing that this isn't just take our money and then leave us alone. They have a responsibility, just like an airline, to ensure our safety in a nice environment. And I'm getting really angry with this. And look at this kind of a thing happening here. And I hope that, you know, perhaps we should be writing our local congressmen that they should be instilling some kind of rule here. I think it's just appalling that, nothing is done about these kind of things and that movie theaters are allowed to just let things slip further and further into literal chaos. And someone actually lose their lives over this because I think movie theaters aren't stepping up. I think that all of this would have been avoided where was that theater manager that the 71-year-old went to get? Could he not find him? Would he not come into the theater? That man would probably still be alive today if the movie theater had been more, on top of this. And think of the people in Colorado who would have been alive if that movie theater had cared more about security. I just think it's really appalling. It makes me angry. And I think that because clearly movie theaters don't care about you, you have to really watch yourself when you go and you're interacting with other people in very increasingly tense situations. All right, so that's the third story of the day. Let's go to the viewer question. It's from Anandi Mishra, who says, question, long-time viewer, but not the first time question. I know, Anandi. I see your comments all the time. I'm glad that YouTube allows people to use avatars now. It's easier for me to recognize regular viewers, so I know who you guys are. And Anandi Mishra says, my question is, what is your reaction on The Hunger Games passing Iron Man 3 as the highest grossing movie in the U.S. market? And do you think that it has any chance of overtaking Iron Man 3 in the global box office, a.k.a. the worldwide box office? Great question, Anandi. I was going to address it in Movie Math yesterday. I didn't quite have the time in the episode. But I wanted to talk about it here today. It's true. The Hunger Games has taken into date $413 million in the United States as opposed to Iron Man 3's $409 million. So it has surpassed it. It is the most successful film of the year at the U.S. box office. But as we all know, the global box office is becoming the more important barometer of success. Iron Man 3 is still the number one film worldwide with $1.2 billion. But The Hunger Games, still playing in theaters, is up to $846 million. But it's about $400 million behind Iron Man 3. And because of that, Anandi, I do not feel that it will be able to surpass... I don't feel Hunger Games will be able to close that $400 million gap. largely because it's pretty much playing everywhere it's going to play around the world. There are no countries left to go. Several of you have said, well, you know, Frozen has a chance at the billion dollar mark because it hasn't opened in China, for instance. And I think that is a valid argument. But Hunger Games has opened in China. It's opened in China, it's in Russia, it's made quite a bit of money in the UK, over 50 million. That's huge for the UK. It's opened in Mexico. It's opened in all, some of you are saying Brazil is also a big market. It's opened in Mexico. It's opened in all these countries. So there's no big country left to go. So I don't know where that $400 million would come from. But still, despite not being able to catch Iron Man 3 worldwide, I think that this domestic success is still a huge turning point. And I think potentially the first time in the history of cinema, I'll have to look into this actually, it's just occurring to me now, that a film starring a female character is the highest grossing movie of the year. I mean, that's just really amazing. That's really impressive. I guess in the past there have been movies such as The Sound of Music is a very big grosser when you adjust for inflation, Gone with the Wind, these star female characters, but they're more, I think, you could say chick flicks, family flicks. This is, I think, very much a female action role, and I think that's very exciting. And I think what we can hope from this is that, you know, I was talking at the beginning of the episode, we'd love to see more diversity in our comic book movies, and also gender diversity, and I'm really hoping that the comic book companies, well, actually Disney and Warner Brothers, who are the studios behind these movies, look at this and go, well, maybe we should make that Black Widow movie. Maybe we can make that Wonder Woman movie. I think those are the movies we're all eager to see. I think the success of Captain America 2 will go a long way to predicting if there is a Black Widow movie, but I think that that's kind of what this door will open. And I also think it points out that women are a very powerful commodity at the box office, the female moviegoer. I think for a long time it was felt that males in the 18 to 25 range drove the box office, and for instance their dates went to the movies that the guy suggested. And there were phenomenons like Sex and the City, obviously, but you know, women weren't a huge, demographic. But at the same time, that's not to discredit the male fans of The Hunger Games. I know there are a lot of you. I see you in the comments. The Hunger Games just seems to have universal appeal, as any good movie should. So I think it also just speaks to, we've been discussing a lot here, Lionsgate's ability to turn this franchise around, and I think have a movie that is deserving of this. I think Hunger Games, Catching Fire, was a better movie than Iron Man 3. I really enjoyed Iron Man 3, as you might call from my review, but I feel it missed the mark with the villain in that end fight scene. You know, I think it didn't stick with you. But I saw Catching Fire twice in theaters, and I did not do the same with Iron Man 3. So fascinating development, and I think it's very interesting for what this could mean for movies going forward, both with female characters and with the comic book genre, and just, these franchises don't have to be, what you would say a traditional franchise. There's room for experimentation, which is very exciting. All right, so that's today's morning movie news. Thank you for tuning in. Please write down below what you think of today's stories, the viewer question, and anything you'd like to see covered tomorrow, and any questions you might have. Thanks for watching.